Hello, hello. Happy Tuesday evening, one and all. And one question for you. Who's ready to get depressed? I say that because we are going to go into some pretty dark territory. And just want you to buckle up straight away. I mean, let's be honest here. We're telling ghost stories most of the time. Those don't start or end with happy endings. So the comment of the day is not just one particular comment, but one I've gotten many, many times over the last, well, close to 5 years now, which is do a video about Elisa Lam, who we will go into a lot of detail, but she had a very mysterious, high profile disappearance, and eventually they did find her body, so death as well, which has way more questions than answers. And that is basically the theme about what this video is going to be about. We are up to the letter E, and I was first thinking of covering Elizabeth Short, better known as the Black Dahlia, and then Ursula Bielski. And like I said, many other people have been wanting me to do a video where I talk about Elisa Lam, Los Angeles, another Los Angeles case like Elizabeth Short. And then I realized that there's this tragic, very old story about a girl named Emma Voelcker, V-O-E-L-K-E-R. I was trying to find any kind of video that where you could hear her name, and I couldn't find it anywhere. So I might be the first person on YouTube trying to do something, which how often can you say that? I'm going to go Voelcker. Emma Voelcker. And so we will start out right there. Also, let's get the child homicide out of the way. This is a very, very sad story, as they all will be. But they do all, they're mysterious stories. They are stories that might have some ghosts or some residual energy left behind. And they are all about why I'm interested in ghost hunting and doing this paranormal stuff in the very onset. So first off, just want to say also, leave comments, chat with me now if you're here. If you end up watching this after the fact, I'm definitely still going to be responding to comments. Check us out all over the place. What'syourghoststory.com. Welcome to the letter E. So this first story takes us to the small town of Seguin, Texas, one of the oldest towns in a very old state of Tejas. The year is 1874. Now, this is an interesting one. The story revolves around the Magnolia Hotel in Seguin. However, the murder didn't happen there, which I was kind of surprised to find today, because as I hear about it over and over again, I just assumed the murder must have taken place here. But really what happened was that this is where the murderer was residing when he hopped on a horse and rode off about 2 hours away to commit this heinous crime, and then came back. And for whatever reason, the hauntings are happening at this other location, the Magnolia Hotel, which still stands today. It seems to be probably a place where you can rent it out to go ghost hunting. There is a family, the Gettys, who reside there now. They live on the first floor, but there's a lot of rooms. This is an old hotel after all. And as the story went, William Faust was a guy in a marriage that he wanted to be out of. And so, well, how do you do that? How would a good Christian go about, well, you can't get a divorce, so I might as well resort to homicide, right? And so he sent his wife off. He was a druggist. He was working in town and would often send his wife off to stay with his sister, who is really the one he wanted to get with. So his idea was, I'll go out, I'll murder my wife, and then I'll shack up with his sister. It's a family man. The wife apparently would get lonely, understandably so. So she had a bit of a roommate who, as far as I can interpret, was her niece. They shared a room together, and usually she would sleep on the floor while the little girl, the 12-year-old Emma, got to sleep in the bed. Well, on this one particular night, William Faust shows up with an axe to go kill his wife, and ends up killing Emma instead, this poor little girl. He eventually realizes in the middle of the act that he's making a huge mistake. Insert your Arrested Development gif there. And he then takes an axe to his wife. He ends up blinding her, but not killing her. Yes, this is getting darker and darker, if you could possibly imagine. He doesn't kill her. He doesn't finish the job. He gets spooked. A family member ends up hearing a commotion and coming in, and he runs off. But he's found out not all that much later. Why? Well, when all the town is in an uproar and trying to find the killer, including the person that maimed his wife. He doesn't really seem all that interested in trying to help out. And that seems suspicious. And eventually they arrest him. They question him. He confesses. He gets life in jail, which people are not too happy about. There are some lynch mobs that go out. He survives the lynch mobs, but eventually he is assassinated. He is shot through his jail cell doors or through a window. He is killed. Now, jump to modern day, some, 130 years later plus. And there's activity in the Magnolia Hotel. There's actually apparently all sorts of activity. This place does go back to the mid-1800s and was inhabited for a very long time. There's all sorts of stories of death. A lot of those are coming from mediums that are giving their interpretations of things. So it's getting to the point where it's tough to separate truth from fiction, or I shouldn't say fiction, but verified truth versus unverified truth. And now the stories are being retold and retold and retold. Of course, the murder of Emma is a very well-known one. Lots of documentation. And people have been able to get some unique things on camera there. I would recommend people, if they want to look this up, check out the Magnolia Hotel on YouTube and look for Strange Town covers it. This is a local TV show, a web show out of Austin. Actually, I think they're on PBS down in Texas as well. Also, there's a ghost hunting group down there. I think it's something like the RIP crew, RIP Paranormal. If you look up Magnolia Hotel, Haunted Austin, or Haunted Segan, you'll find it. But they got some really interesting things where toys would start to move on their own. And some of the videos kind of skin crawly. It's like, ooh, okay, yeah, that was something. They do stuff with a pinwheel that starts to spin on its own, and also a ball that very subtly, but also very obviously, starts to move by some unseen force when they ask, hey, Emma, do you want to play with this ball? So it does seem to be an actively haunted location. That one is the only story of these three where we know the entire crime from beginning to end. Next, we will head into Los Angeles in the 1940s, this kind of a romantic time for this growing, bustling city. It is already the movie capital. People are heading out there to try to, get their shot at stardom. There's a lot of people that claim Elizabeth Short, who was originally from Boston and had family up in the Bay Area. A lot of people claim that she was an aspiring actress, but I don't think we really even know that for sure. She never got any parts, at the very least. We can say that much. And if you end up before I go on, the band Sunspot did this amazingly beautiful and appropriately tragically sad song for Emma called Emma, and you can check that out. There's a direct link to the song, streaming version of the song in the description below. You can also find a link to the See You on the Other Side podcast episode. That's See You on the Other Side, or othersidepodcast.com/99, where they interview the Strange Town guys out of Austin that did the investigation. And I'm sure they talk about more than just Emma's story as well. Of course. Thanks for creating such awesome stuff that you share with the world. But moving back to Los Angeles, 1947, Elizabeth Short. I was going to get to that. If you really want to follow up more with the Black Dahlia story, which is Elizabeth Short, there's a link to a video I did a few years back where I visit a whole bunch of sites around Los Angeles, from Hollywood to downtown LA, and eventually where her body was found. Just kind of a Black Dahlia tour, a video tour, if you will. And it's really interesting, and I think it's important as people that are trying to learn more, people that are trying to investigate, to try to not just go to, okay, well, people say her ghost is seen here, or go to her burial site, which those are important too, but let's find any place. Try to forge some connection between yourself and this person that you're trying to kind of understand one of the most intimate parts of their entire life, that being their demise. So we start out at, I can't remember the name of the apartment complex right now, but it's on Cherokee in Hollywood, right on the Strip. I mean, it's prime location and it's very occupied. I don't know exactly what room she was in. If anybody lives in that building up on Cherokee, north of Hollywood Boulevard, and have any paranormal experiences, any odd feelings, anything, let us know. Leave comments, write to me. It would be fascinating to find out, because just south of Hollywood Boulevard, so less than two blocks, and this was apparently a trip Elizabeth would make on occasion. That was her local watering hole. It's this awesome place called Boardners. It goes back to the early glory days of Hollywood, and it's still a kicking, rocking joint. And when I first went there, it wasn't there the last time I was there, but when I first went there, they had this special drink menu that said all of the regulars through the years, like going back to Mickey Mantle or John Wayne and Lucille Ball, and what their drink was. And they actually had Elizabeth Short's name on there, and they just had beer next to her. I guess they didn't know exactly what label she liked, or maybe she didn't care. She was just a beer drinker. But that's the one and only location where people have claimed to make contact with her, is in the women's restroom at Boardner's. As we talked a couple episodes ago, women's bathrooms seem to be haunted a lot. At least this time it's by a female entity, where apparently people can hear Elizabeth singing, crooning in the restroom. Seems to be a residual haunting. Nobody's made any claims that they've made any sort of contact, had a conversation or anything, but still worth looking further. And we talked to some employees there that shared a murder that happened in the alleyway right next to the place. And that, to them, is the most haunted and creepy place. Usually people are freaked out in the basement, but they say the alley next to it, which actually is a beautiful area. You'll see it in the video because it's kind of connected now. There's a canopy that overhangs the alley, and there's benches in there. There's lighting. It's not a spooky alley, but to them, that is the actively haunted place. But by some other murder victim. Famously, I guess I'm burying the lead a little bit. You all know about the Black Dahlia. For why? Well, her body was found in the most egregious, terrifying, terrible way. It was found by a mom who was going for a walk, pushing her baby in a stroller, and thought she had come across a mannequin that was in pieces. But no, unfortunately, it was a human being that was in pieces. The Black Dahlia, Elizabeth Short, was cut in half and was further mutilated even beyond that. And I'll spare details because that's not relevant. That's not important to what we do and why we're doing this. And so that happened. Her disappearance happened January 9th. So it's funny. I got two winter ones. Anyway, January 9th is when she went missing. The last place she was seen alive, she was dropped off at the Biltmore Hotel, which is this beautiful, gorgeous, luxury hotel in downtown Los Angeles. I urge everybody to go there. An interesting thing is both at Boardner's and at the Biltmore, they each, their bars have a drink named after the Black Dahlia. But anyway, so she was dropped off there, and employees of the Biltmore recall seeing her there. They said she was frantically making phone calls near this bank of phones. Now, the difference between 1947 and today is they moved where the front of the hotel is. The old front of the hotel, they just kind of don't use so much anymore. And they create this really nice big area where you can drop off passengers and pick up. So now, if you're looking for where that would have been, you would go to the back doors of the hotel, which is in this incredible grand foyer, I guess you would say. And you would, once you, if you ever get a chance to visit the place, you'll recognize it from tons of movies. It is understandably in everything all the time. It's kind of funny that I've never run into a movie crew there with as frequently as I see this on screen, whether it's a commercial or movie or TV show. So getting back to the paranormal side. Now, the Biltmore has its own legends and lore. People do not claim any Elizabeth Short ghost sightings here. However, how amazing would it be if you were to go into this area where the phone banks used to be, do EVP sessions, do them frequently? What if, as she was making those frantic last phone calls that would eventually lead to maybe some of the last conversations she ever had? We definitely know she died not long after. Maybe it's related to her death. Maybe it's not. But if they are related to her death, and if an EVP, even if it's just a residual haunting and you're not pulling anything out, you're just happen to be there to document. If you happen to pick up something interesting on the recording that might open a door and have us start to shed light and look in a different direction, maybe one that we had no reason to look in before, maybe that will be that first domino that falls, and more dominoes will fall. And eventually, perhaps we can begin to decipher who it was that did this killing. What exactly happened? What was this story here? Now, one of the, in modern times, and just really in the last handful of years, there is a guy named Steve Hodel, or is it George? It's Steve Hodel, who is trying desperately, and he's getting a lot of attention to prove that it was his dad that committed this act and committed so many others. He's trying to blame him for the Zodiac killings up in the Bay Area. Now, there is a chance that whoever did the Black Dahlia killing is also the Chicagoan, or the person who did the lipstick murders in Chicago around that same time period. There are similarities in the case. But so, of course, Mr. Hodel is trying to blame them all on his dad, George Hodel. George Hodel was a physician, which that lines up a lot with some of the Black Dahlia theories, that somebody to be able to cut the body as this person obviously was able to must have had some sort of medical training. However, the type of doctor Dr. Hodel was not a surgeon, so it's kind of irrelevant. All of his bits of evidence are so tenuous at best, and they're designed to sell books, unfortunately. It would be wonderful. We all want resolution to this, which I think is why people are latching on, just because we want to finally know what the answer is. But one of his big smoking guns is, in his father's effects, he found two photographs that he claimed were of Elizabeth Short, which even that would be interesting, but it wouldn't prove anything. But we've found out that, one of the photos that he put on display, somebody was able to say, no, that's me, and I'm not Elizabeth Short. So you can throw that one out. And the family of Elizabeth Short looked at the other one and said, no, that's absolutely not her. So both photos have been thrown out. But he's still persisting, and he's still getting plenty of press for it. So it's unfortunate because it's pulling people away from whatever the real story is. Now, by all means, George Hodel apparently was a really creepy dude. There was a reason he was being investigated by the LAPD. He was at one point one of over 150 people that were questioned in relation to the Black Dahlia, Elizabeth Short's death. But he was never considered a serious suspect, and he still isn't. The last place we cover in the video is we go down to Leimert Park, just south of Crenshaw Boulevard, where I used to live. And the area where her body was found is now a neighborhood. And so it's it's completely jarring that somebody's front yard was the site of this horrific. The murder probably didn't happen there, but at least just the body being left there has gotta feel odd, knowing that that's your front yard. The sidewalk is going right through where her body was found. Another little interesting side note is that the Hodel house is one of the more eye-catching houses in Los Angeles. It's actually referred to as the Sowden house. It's on Franklin, also in the, I was going to say near Hollywood, but in Los Feliz, one of my favorite neighborhoods in LA. And it was designed by Lloyd Wright, who was Frank Lloyd Wright's son. And I was fortunate enough I worked on a movie and we shot next door to it. I worked on actually this movie right here, Blue Dream. And next door was this incredible building. It looks kind of like an Aztec temple, some say. Some claim it looks like a shark. If you're looking at it from the front, like Jaws jumping out of the water, because it is a very pyramid type building up with those kind of Aztec blocks. It's a really unique building. And there are claims of that place being haunted. Now, again, George Hodel was a bad dude. Most people don't think he actually killed Elizabeth Short, but there are claims that let's keep this dark, right? He perhaps molested his daughter. I think that's actually well known that he did do that, and who knows what other types of terrible things. So the idea that that house is haunted is not surprising at all. And a really interesting thing, something that I've always wanted to try to follow up on, was that there's one season of America's Next Top Model that shot in the house. Like that's where they put the models up. Do any of them have ghost stories? Any of the crew? I don't know. You would assume that somebody has something to say, even if they didn't know about the history of it. If that place is an actively darkly haunted place, you would assume that somebody felt something. And especially if there's some kind of creepy, lecherous entity behind, if George Hodel himself is what's left behind. And now with houses full of models, he's not going to be quiet during that. So moving ahead to a very, very contemporary story is Elisa Lam, and her disappearance and death happened less than a year before I began doing tours in Los Angeles. And it was odd that odd's not really the right word, but it was, as the person that was giving the tour, it was weird to me that just coincidentally we gave tours Friday through Sunday every single week. That one of those days happened to be on the 1 year anniversary of her death. And then we're telling these stories, and it's such a fresh and still I mean, it's still unsolved, but at that time it was very, very, very new. So Elisa Lam, this is one of the most mysterious cases I've ever researched and looked into deeply. She was a Canadian exchange student. She was down here in Los Angeles, down there in Los Angeles. I mean, being in Los Angeles, so I'm telling the story. And one day she was, so she's a foreign exchange student. She's a college student. She doesn't have a lot of money. She's staying at a place that's basically a hostel. It was called the Cecil Hotel at the time that she was there. It still, to this day, has the very old, faded sign painted on the side of the building. That's actually, if you go to facebook.com/whatsyourghoststory, you'll see that's the thumbnail. That's our icon, I guess you would say. Low monthly, weekly rates, 700 rooms, it says. Well, those rooms have a lot of stories. Elisa was going to check out one day and then head up to Santa Cruz. She talked to her parents on that last day. I keep saying last day because that's the last day really we know much about her. That was January 31st, 2013. She never made contact with her parents again. A couple days pass. You know, she's probably out gallivanting, having fun, and just not thinking to check in. But indeed, it's unlike her. The parents come into town. They start asking around, looking around. The police do a search of the building. They don't find anything. At that time, they didn't have search warrants to go any super deep into it. But as more time passes, they're able to get more search warrants and scour the property more. And it's at that point that they discovered a security camera footage that was taped the next day, February 1st, 2013. And this is incredibly famous footage right now. Anytime you look up creepiest videos ever on YouTube or anything along those lines, this is on the top of most lists because it's so unsettling to watch. You don't see, there's nothing gory about it. There's nothing profane. There's nothing gross, but it's uneasy. First off, you know, we're seeing the last footage ever taken of this person while she was alive. But it also just, it's how it plays out, how she acts is so strange. We see this woman walk into the elevator very gracefully, very calm. And unusually, instead of just picking your floor and then standing and waiting, she went over and pushed every single button and stood there and waited. And the elevator doors didn't close. Why they didn't close, who knows? But the longer these doors don't close, the more unsettled her body language conveys. She, at different times, she either gets really small and hides into a corner. Sometimes she darts her head out into the hallway, looking around as if she's suddenly has a reason to be fearful or hiding from somebody. Eventually, she steps out of the elevator, she steps on a couple times, but eventually she steps out of the elevator and turns 90 degrees and starts to have this very animated conversation. She's moving her hands around. She's gesturing. It's peculiar. And eventually the elevator doors do close without her getting on the elevator. And the last bit of the footage is just, you see this empty elevator going up and doors opening and closing, operating as usual again. So right off the bat, we have a lot of questions. Most people, I'll go forward again first. So once this footage was found, they know she was here longer than they thought she was going to be here. The search is more exhaustive. Around this time, actually more than 2 weeks after her first disappearance, it was February 19th, residents begin to complain about the bad water pressure in their hotel rooms. And some reports have come out later. I don't know if this is true, but it's what's being reported, that people would say that the water was discolored, had an odd taste. So, of course, maintenance goes up to look at the water tanks on top of the building. And that's where they find Elisa's body. She's been there for over 2 weeks. And of course now, her body's in rough shape. She has passed. She has passed a long time ago. There are so many questions about this. The elevator is incredibly full of questions. People assume when they see how she's acting, they ask, well, what is she on? She must be on mushrooms or some sort of psychedelic. She's not. The autopsy report showed that she had some like Tylenol in her system. She had a trace amount of alcohol, but she definitely was not hammered. She didn't have anything else going on. She was bipolar. Was she having a psychotic break? That is up for anyone's guess. But she's definitely not on any kind of, she's only on prescribed medications, and we see that she's following orders. But then the other questions remain. How did she get, what's going on the elevator? Obviously, a lot of people question, was it a resident, or not a resident, but an employee of the hotel who was involved in this killing, and he knew where to stand, or he or she would know where to stand so that the elevator security cameras wouldn't capture any video of them. It's a good guess. We don't know. Another question is, how did she get to the rooftop? The staircase, apparently it was possible to be adventurous and go up and get to the highest fire escape, perhaps, and then climb up that way, Spider-Man-like. Maybe that's a little exaggeration, but still not the most convenient way. The regular staircase that went to the rooftop was locked. And okay, now she's on the rooftop. Why is she, how did she get access to these water tanks? They're, you know, 12 some feet tall. You'd need a ladder. How did she get in there? We don't know. We have no idea. Also, one of the things that's odd is that she's found naked in the water tank, but her clothes are in there. They're floating in there, and they seem to be covered with the material of the rooftop. So, you know, that kind of sandy, gravel-ish like stuff that you'd find on the top of a roof. So the idea is that perhaps she got in somehow and went skinny dipping, but she left her clothes behind. But then somebody else then would have taken her clothes and thrown them into the tank to make her harder to find. We have no idea. There's, you know, something like this happens and it's just more and more and more urban legend. There's a creepypasta called the Elevator Game that I think has come out. I don't know, maybe it was out before then, but it certainly wasn't well known. But that's become attached with the Elisa Lam case. It has hit pop culture big time. There's a movie coming out later this year that's going to use that as the backdrop to a lot of it. American Horror Story covered it during one of their seasons. But perhaps the most unusual bit of pop culture connection is a movie with Jennifer Connelly titled Dark Water that is the Elisa Lam case. It's a woman and her daughter who are living in this dumpy apartment. I think they're in New York, though. Her daughter's name is Cecilia, which is interesting because where Elisa Lam died was the Cecil. So a little bit of a hat tip almost to it. And their house is haunted, or their apartment is haunted. The watercolor changes, loses pressure, gets dark. It turns out that there's a dead body floating in the water tank on top of their building. There are more similarities beyond that, but it's just kind of a unique, wow, which predicted which? One of the other things that I think is fascinating is that shortly after Elisa Lam's death and disappearance, there was a tuberculosis outbreak in that part of Los Angeles among the homeless population. And it is kind of a skid row area. The amazing thing is the kit, and I've actually looked this up to verify this is true, and it is, the medical kit that they use to verify whether or not you have tuberculosis is called the Lam Elise kit. So it's her actual name, just last name first. What are the odds? To this day, her death is ruled accidental death by drowning. So the idea is that she went up there to go for a swim and got stuck, which I suppose is possible, but there's still so many more question marks, and nobody really sits, that doesn't really sit well with most people, that, especially if you've seen the video, there's more questions that need to be answered. So thank you for, and so this is a place that, the Cecil Hotel, which is now rebranded the Stay on Main, because now that it has a new name, you'll totally forget that story. And oh yeah, two other serial killers lived at this site at different times. Recent history, the Richard Ramirez, the Night Stalker, was living there up to the time he got captured. And after them, Jack Unterweger, a German serial killer who was quite the fan of Richard Ramirez, apparently, stayed there as well, kind of to pay homage. And he was committing murders as well. It's a hotel that goes back a long way. It's a hotel that goes back to pre-Depression era. There's lots of reported documented suicides in that location. I could go on and on about this building itself. The fact that Elisa Lam also met her mysterious demise there is just one more story in a mountain of other dark moments. But let's look forward right now. I do hope people do paranormal investigations at all of these locations to try to make contact, try to solve some gaps in our knowledge. Maybe one day we can find out more about what happened to Elizabeth Short and Elisa Lam. Tomorrow, I will be back. You guys, your votes were loud and clear. I thought maybe there's going to be a lot of people that wanted to hear about fraudulent psychics and whatnot, but that was not the case. The Flying Dutchman will be my topic for tomorrow. Only two of you voted for frauds, which we'll work it in some other way. But we'll be talking about the Flying Dutchman tomorrow. We will be talking about ghost hunting in general when we get to G. We will talk about some frauds when we get to Harry Houdini, who would love to expose fraudulent psychics. But I want your help to let me know what we want to talk about with the letter I. This kind of looks like an I. letter I. Let me know. Go over to whatsyourghoststory.com. Head on over to facebook.com/whatsyourghoststory. Leave comments. Let me know anything in the letter I that you would like for me to cover. Thanks for watching. I hope you didn't watch this right before bed. Sweet dreams.